Good morning. So today we're going to talk about acute coronary syndromes. I'm going to go through quite a bit of information here, so I'm going to try to move expeditiously. I like to initially present on epidemiology. We'll get into pathophysiology, diagnosis, and some future therapy as far as STEMI goes. And through the talk, there are a couple of places where there are some board questions that I'd like you to take note of. So acute coronary syndromes in the U.S., approximately 800,000 Americans pass away annually of cardiovascular disease. Cardiovascular disease is made up of coronary heart disease or atherosclerotic coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease, congestive heart failure, cardiac arrhythmias, and valvular heart disease. Coronary heart disease or atherosclerosis is responsible for the majority of cardiovascular deaths. Every year, there are approximately 790 acute coronary syndromes in the U.S. About 580,000 Americans experience their first MI, and another 210,000 experience a second MI, and there are approximately 370,000 deaths. And about every 40 seconds, someone in the U.S. experiences an MI. Now, before we delve into the talk further, it's important to always keep in mind your differential diagnosis. So when I'm called to see a person with a STEMI or chest pain, some of the other things that I'm thinking of are a pneumothorax, an acute aortic syndrome, a pulmonary embolus, and a perforated viscus. So if you miss one of those, your patient will likely suffer an unfortunate demise. So whenever you see a patient with chest pain, it's always important to keep those in the backs of your mind. So over the years, I can't tell you how many times I've been called for a STEMI and the patient winds up having a pulmonary embolus or an aortic dissection. So very important. So hospitalizations due to acute coronary syndrome. So approximately 1.6 million hospitalizations are due to ACS, and as you can see, a fraction of those are STEMI, and the majority of those are related to unstable angina and NSTEMI. This is a classification system for acute MIs that wasn't really around when I was a fellow back in the 2000-2003 era, but this is a classification scheme that we use for research purposes and to be mindful of the pathophysiology. So a type 1 MI is the classic MI that occurs as a result of plaque rupture. A type 2 MI is the type that occurs predominantly due to a supply and demand mismatch. So if there's a patient that may have a 50 or 60% stable stenosis, they suffer a GI bleed or pneumonia, that can trigger a myocardial infarction. A type 3 MI is that associated with sudden cardiac death. Type 4A MI is associated with a PCI, 4B is associated with stent thrombosis, and a type 5 is associated with coronary bypass grafting. And this classification scheme is something that I would just advise keeping in mind, and definitely something you probably see on your boards. In terms of the diagnosis, so you know, again, a good history and physical really is key in making the diagnosis of an acute coronary syndrome. Electrocardiograms, biomarkers, and a chest x-ray. So typically when you're called down to see a person with an ACS, the chest x-ray is probably already performed, the EKG is performed. One of the other things that I like to order from time to time is a D-dimer, and colleagues may have variable feelings about that. A negative D-dimer essentially has a very high negative predictive value in terms of diagnosing a pulmonary embolus or acute aortic syndrome. So we use that sometimes if there's a suspicion to eliminate that and allow us to move in the direction of atherosclerosis. This is a busy slide here, which just goes over a little bit of the pathophysiology. To the far left is a stable plaque that's severely stenosed. In the middle section is a plaque that has ruptured and showed a partially occluded artery, and then to the far right is a completely occluded artery that we see in STEMI. So as you know, most myocardial infarctions occur as a result of blockages that are about 50 to 60% that are unstable. And the ones that we tend to treat that are stable are usually over 70% and have hemodynamic significance. So this is something to keep in mind, that most MIs occur from moderate atherosclerosis. This is another busy slide here that really goes a little bit more of the pathophysiology. So typically in the setting of an MI, you may have a 50% blockage that ruptures as a result of some environmental trigger. That may be blood pressure, that may be exertion, it may be spontaneous. Some of these plaques go on to heal and form a more severe blockage. But if the thrombogenic surface is exposed, you may get a partial occlusion, which results in unstable angina or in-STEMI. If there's a complete occlusion, you'll get a STEMI. Okay? And this is another slide here that just illustrates histology associated with the stable plaque on the far left, unstable angina, in-STEMI in the middle, and then a STEMI to the right with a complete occlusion. Now, this slide is potentially maybe a board question on this. So this gets more into the pathophysiology of what causes acute coronary syndrome. So the vast majority occur as a result of plaque rupture. This is followed by plaque erosion, and also calcified nodules can result in acute coronary syndrome. And for STEMIs, the majority of STEMIs are caused by plaque rupture, and the majority of in-STEMIs are caused by plaque erosion. So that's a definite board question right there that I've seen on the interventional boards. Okay. And again, the pathophysiology for unstable angina in-STEMI is plaque, plaque erosion. For STEMI, it's plaque rupture that leads to a thrombus formation. Now I have a few EKGs to put up so to make you familiar with classic STEMI presentation. So this is a typical inferior MI. So you can see SE segment elevation in leads 2, 3, and F, and some reciprocal changes in the precordial leads. So you'll definitely see ST elevation in your training, and it's sometimes it can be a conundrum to differentiate this between pericarditis. So pericarditis, you have kind of diffuse ST segment elevation. So you'll, middle of the night, be in situations where you're trying to differentiate an actual STEMI from pericarditis. And I will say you probably will take people to the lab with pericarditis. I've done that. I'm sure all of my colleagues have done that. This is an anterior MI. You can see ST segment elevations in leads V1 through V3. It's a classic anterior MI. Now, the next two EKGs are patients that you treat as a STEMI that may not necessarily have ST segment elevation. So this is a classic posterior MI. So if you have this EKG and you invert it, you'll see ST segment elevations in leads V1 through 3. So this is a classic posterior MI, but should be treated as a STEMI. And this next slide is a left bundle branch block. So this is in patients with a new onset left bundle branch block, you should classically treat those as a STEMI. So we're going to get into the treatment. This next slide is a little busy. It's actually taken directly from the guidelines. And there are board questions which would come from this slide. So to the left of the slide is the protocol for STEMI. And with STEMI, you want to measure the time from initial medical contact to device. So that should be under 90 minutes. And to the right are recommendations regarding systems that don't necessarily have PCI-capable hospitals. So ideally, you'd want to transfer your patient to a PCI-capable hospital if you can get them there within 120 minutes. So that's going to be a board question. If you can't get the patient there within 120 minutes, they should receive fibrinolytics. Okay, so that's something to keep in mind. To the right are the in-STEMI recommendations. And I will tell you that in practice, we treat our in-STEMI patients very aggressively. So if we have a person that comes in with positive biomarkers, abnormal electrocardiogram, those patients will usually go to the cath lab right away for urgent treatment. The ones that we don't treat as aggressively are patients that may have concomitant renal failure, GI bleeding, or stroke, or some type of GI issue, some other concomitant problem that would prohibit anticoagulation or their aggressive treatment. Okay. Now, lastly, I'm going to touch on an issue. I know Dr. Kleinman talked about reducing mortality in STEMI. So these next couple of slides are going to go over femoral versus radial access. So treating your patients with the STEMI via radial access is one way in this current era that we're in that can likely help further reduce mortality in your patients with STEMI. So there are three trials, which I'm just going to briefly mention here to just make you aware of the fact that treating your patients by the radial approach may help improve outcomes. And before attempting routinely treating your patients from a radial standpoint, I would advise really feeling comfortable with the radial approach. I've probably done thousands of these, so before we started this at our institution, the operators were very comfortable with this approach. So this first trial is the RIVAL trial. There are about 7,000 patients randomized to radial versus femoral access. And as you can see that in the primary outcome, you know, the STEMI patients did better with radial versus the femoral access. Death, MI, and stroke in STEMI patients was also shown to be improved. Overall death was improved. Major bleeding trended more in favor of our patients that underwent radial access, and then major vascular complications were in favor of the radial access as well. This is the RIFLE trial. There are 1,000 patients with ST segment elevation randomized to radial versus femoral. And you can see that at 30 days, the NACE rate, which is basically the MACE plus bleeding, was in favor of radial access. The mortality was 5.2% in the radial patients and 9.2% in the femoral patients. See, the bleeding was reduced as well, and a shorter hospital stay. And the MATRIX trial was a larger trial, and this is just one slide which kind of reviews that. And you can see the primary endpoint, the radial access as in red, was reduced. All-cause mortality was reduced, and bleeding was also reduced. And these are some things to keep in mind. And lastly, I'm going to just leave you with this thought. Some of the newer innovations or changes to our program that we're considering are putting the cardiologist directly in touch with our EMS personnel. Currently, our STEMIs are activated by EMS, but we're looking at apps that will put the cardiologist directly in contact with our EMS personnel to help further facilitate the treatment of STEMI patients. So thank you very much for your attention.